Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Pop Art Hunter channel, and today we're going to be talking a little bit about consignment, whether it be with a gallery or whether it be with an auction house, and what's the best way to go about doing that. Is it a good idea? Is it a bad idea versus trying to sell something personal out of your collection, either through, you know, more of a casual auction site or, you know, through some sort of a local means or possibly even, you know, on social media or something like that. So anyway, we've talked about this in general, looking at art as an investment and whether or not you should consider the collection that you have as an investment. And there's different levels of that. And we have another video regarding those types of aspects, whether you're collecting for the joy of it or investment or a little bit of both. But you need to be aware that views change, nostalgia changes, you know, you have ups and dips in the market based on what people are feeling about the nostalgia of a particular show that they're looking for, whether that be, you know, animation sales like I have back here, or whether it be things like Ninja Turtles that I more recently got into. You know, that's right now kind of skyrocketing because people of a certain age have some expendable income and they're saying, I want to relive my childhood and now I'm going to get that. Well, in 5 years from now, those things might not be worth a lot or of anything, you know? And so it's kind of got its swings. It swings with the valuation of it. It's kind of like the stock market. You have ups and you have downs. So if you're deciding to sell, you need to think about whether it's the right time to sell. That's the first thing. But once you've decided, yes, now is the time. I want to either upgrade my collection and buy some better things or different things. I'm going to get some funds from my existing collection to do so. Or you think, you know, this is the time to make the money where I'm going to get a good value for it. I'm never going to get these high prices again. Once you've made that decision, now, how do you sell it? So if you sell something personally, or if you sell something through like a casual auction site or something, oftentimes you can get more money from it if it sells. That's the caveat. You can set a price for it. You can say, I want $1,000 for this, personally through, you know, a social media channel or locally or something like that within your community. You can say, I want $1,000, give me $1,000. And so you essentially, if you sell that, you have to pay your, you know, taxes for any like capital gains or something like that. But other than that, there's no like fees associated with just selling something personally like that. Now, if you're collecting money via like, you know, some payment gateway, like a PayPal or something like that, then you have a little bit of fees associated with that credit card transaction fee or the fee from the agency, which is, you know, providing that payment method. But it's usually, you know, not a huge fee, you know, you take off a couple bucks. Then you've got the casual auction sites where they're going to take a little bit more of a fee. You got to deal with some shipping. You have to deal with those types of things. But ultimately, if you ask for $1,000, you're going to be getting pretty close to the $1,000. Now, the problem is you also take away a little bit of the ability for somebody to want to buy it when you post on those channels versus something else. Unless it's a really good deal, people are looking for that super deal there. With a large auction house or a prestigious art gallery, individuals sometimes are willing to pay more. I don't know what the psychology of it is behind it, as far as why they're willing to put more money for the same item when it's at a different location. But part of it is because, you know, knowing an agency that you can trust adds a little bit of, you know, it puts your nerves at ease when it comes to purchasing the item, whether or not it's legitimate and those types of things. And so you got a little bit of that going on. And also it's that prestige, it's like that name brand, you know, people like the swoosh on their clothes because, oh, it's a name brand, it's Nike or something like that, versus maybe the same tennis shoe that does something similar. They want to pay for that tag. They want to pay for that brand. They want to say, well, I purchased this from so-and-so, and not just, I found it at a rummage sale in a box. Those stories are usually based on, I found this little nugget of gold that was in a box at a rummage sale. They're not usually paying up at a rummage sale for that thing and then bragging about it. So when you're looking at selling, you have to think, am I going to be able to get that $1,000? And I just use that as a random number that I'm asking for on that auction site. If it's a casual auction site or a social media channel for people you don't know, you don't have any seller rating, you're not very trusted, are people actually going to pay you that $1,000? You might want $1,000, but that's not necessarily what you're going to get for it. Any of the items that you have is only worth the amount of money somebody is willing to pay. The secondary value is what it's worth to you. And so if those two things don't match up, maybe it's not the right time to sell. I have oftentimes wanted to sell something for $1,000 and someone only wants to give me $500 for it. And for me, it's worth more sentimentally or by having it in my collection or knowing what I put into it, that I'm not willing to let it go for that amount. Maybe I'd do it for $800 or $900. If I got $1,000, I'd be happy because that's what I wanted from it. Maybe somebody offers me $1,500. I once sold a piece that I paid $87 for. And I ended up, it was something that was in my collection just because I wanted to have one of each of these types of animation cells. It was from Cartoon Network. And somebody out of the blue said, hey, I really like that cell. I really want it. I'm like, make me an offer. You know, I kind of put it back on them. Like, I can't buy it and sell it kind of thing. Well, that's what they usually say to me, or what I say to the people that tell me to make an offer. But they ended up offering me $1,200 for it. I was like, well, I kind of played hard to get for a little while and was able to sell that to them. But I mean, for me, I made a huge, profit on that, because at the time that I purchased it, they were not that sought after. And all of a sudden they skyrocketed and I was able to get a good price. And so sometimes I'm willing to take the $100, $200, $300, $1,000 cut on one item because I was able to make it up on a different item because the markets fluctuate. So I know there was a lot of rambling, but the major point is, if you want to sell it, you have to put a price on it that you want, and you have to try to get as close to that price as you can by whatever means you can. Sometimes it is worth it to go to a private gallery and consign with them, or to go to a more prestigious auction house and consign with them, because there is a certain level of prestige and air to this, you know, trust the level that's involved with these places and the marketing that they do, and they have a staff of people that sometimes they're able to get more money for it. So even though you have a fee attached, if I want $1,000 for something and I sell it for $1,200 and they take $200 in fees, ultimately I ended up with $1,000 that I wanted. And so it can seem kind of gut-wrenching when you see that something goes for this certain price, but you don't get that full amount. But you also didn't have to do all the work associated with it. You didn't have to market it. You didn't have to curate the list of individuals who might seek these items. Now, I've recently consigned with one art gallery, and then also with a larger name auction house. Now, I'm not going to mention specific names of those. I'm going to get into the details of about how the actual transactions went. And I'm not actually finished with them yet. The auctions are not over yet. I don't know by the time you watch this video, but the auctions aren't over yet. And I haven't yet received a final check from some of the consignments with the gallery. So these are just like the preliminary findings. I'm going to tell you about what my experience has been so far. So with the gallery, they have something like a 35 to 60% fee scale based on what they take. Usually it's in that 35 to 45 range. So essentially, if you sell something for $1,000, you only get 65%. And so they take a lot off the top, or even more than that. Sometimes I've seen galleries that will take even, you know, 60, 40, and they're taking the 60 and you only get the 40. So you have to be careful about what gallery you're looking at. But for me, I was able to tell them a specific price that I wanted. I said, I want no less than $300 on this piece. I don't care what you price that. I don't care what you want to, you know, as far as marketing. If you think you can get $10 million for it and I'm going to get a better rate, that's awesome. But I need $300 minimum, or do not sell it. So I was able to set that minimum range, and they were kind of able to take it over from there. When I started working with them, it was a couple pieces that I no longer really wanted in my collection. I didn't really need them. They weren't things that really spoke to me. I maybe paid up for them a little at the time, you know, kind of in the heat of the moment. And I thought to myself, I really don't need these. So if I get any money from them, it's going to be great. So I set a couple minimum values and I sent them on. I really don't like that consignment experience that I had. Not that this isn't a great gallery. I think that they're doing a great job marketing the pieces. One of the pieces has sold, I think so. they told me that it sold, but it might be on one of their like payment plans, and so I won't know for a while. And it's really not easy to like check the status of your items and stuff with that website. And so I'm not exactly sure how the end result's going to go. But it really kind of rubbed me the wrong way, that percentage. It seemed very high to me. It seemed like a very high percentage. It seemed like the seller was taking on the brunt of the fees, versus if you go sometimes with an auction house, they will not pass on as many fees to you. Now, I've only worked with the one auction house thus far. I've had auctions in the past, so whether it be casual sites or, you know, personal auctions, like in-person live auctions. But this is the first one I've done with a more prestigious auction house. And I think it depends on the amount of items that you provide to them, the dollar value of them. Typically, what they do is it's a 15% fee for your seller portion of it. And that covers all the work that they're doing, the cataloging, the advertisements, the photography, the description writing, the live auction, you know, rallying people up. So you're paying 15%. Now, I think if you consign millions of dollars worth of materials with them, they might put that at 2% or 0% just to keep you coming back because you're having such high value items. But they actually had a $5,000 minimum estimated value for you to even consign with them. If it was less than $5,000, they're like, it's not worth the time. So I was able to get a few items together that would meet that minimum. And what it does is they will take, again, 15% of what the hammer price is from me. They also have a buyer's premium. So if you've ever been involved in an auction, you know, if you're on a casual auction site, there's really no buyer's premium. And so a lot of people are not familiar with that particular concept. If you're on one of these larger sites, and most auction sites, even other casual auction sites, but not the big names, you will pay a buyer's premium. And that can be anywhere from 15% to as high as like 35% that I've seen. And sometimes I guess could be more or less in other places, but I've seen about 15 to 35. And essentially, so with this auction house I'm working with right now with that $5,000 minimum, let's say I have a piece there, it sells for $1,000. That is the hammer price. That's $1,000, that was the final bid. The buyer pays $1,200 because it's a 20% buyer's premium. So it's a $200 fee that is attached to the end total onto that hammer price plus their shipping, everything else. So they pay $1,200. I receive a check for $850 because I'm charged a 15% fee on the hammer price. So it's a lot of math there. Get out your pen and paper. So anyway, item sells for $1,000. I get $850. So it's easy for me to calculate what I would like for it, what it needs to sell for in order for me to get a particular amount. The buyer's premium, it kind of splits that burden between myself and then the buyer. Now, as a buyer, I've always thought, oh, that's so unfair that I have to pay a buyer's premium. But it's sort of a, it's sort of like, I consider it almost like a cover fee. To be able to participate and to engage in this particular auction, you have to kind of pay up a little bit. You have to pay up front. Or it's like a tip at a restaurant. If you had a good experience and you got a decent price or you got the item that you really wanted, you have to kind of pay up. And I know it seems like a weird metaphor. It doesn't really... it doesn't really sort of mesh exactly, but it's not apples to apples. It's apples to kiwis or apples to oranges. But, you know, I think it's nice that that fee is split between the buyer and the seller. You are buying from this bigger auction house. So I have purchased many things from this place and I've never had anything arrive damaged. I've never had any issues with items not arriving or with tracking number issues. I always get quick responses anytime I email their staff. And so I feel like that you're paying for that quality level of service and that efficiency and that responsiveness. You're paying for all of those things. So even as a buyer, you're paying that little tip, you're paying that extra fee. Now, granted, it's a big tip. You know, when you're spending $1,000, you have to pay an extra $200. That's a big deal. Or if you're spending, you know, $1 million and you have to pay $1,200,000. Like, I mean, that adds up really quickly. So 20% is large, but I do like as a seller, being able to have that fee lessened instead of a 35 or 40 or 50% fee, like I've been having the experience with that art gallery specifically. The other thing with the art gallery is I don't know if those items are ever going to sell. I mean, they might sit there forever and get shipped back at my expense for shipping. They might sit there for a while and I don't know if anybody's interested. Somebody might come along that wants the item but doesn't want to pay their price, would have paid me, you know, more than what I will get as a fee back from this gallery, but because it was tied up in the gallery, I can't sell it. So if I wanted $1,000 for it, and they're charging $2,000 for it at their place in order to get the money that they want and give me the money I want, maybe that person that wants to buy it for me would give me $1,500, but they won't give me a dollar more. So I could have made more, but it's tied up in this gallery now. With an auction house, the item is going to sell, and that's part of the fear. You can put a reserve on things, but that usually doesn't go well. Buyers don't like reserves. They don't want to be restricted by that reserve. They want to feel like they have a chance to get a deal, and if they get into a bidding war, that's where sometimes you can get even more value out of it. So, you know, there is an inherent risk of something going for a lot less than you want if you don't put the reserve on it, but the item is going to sell. And so even if it sells for significantly less, it's over, it's done with, there's nothing you can do, and you're going to get a check from it. You are going to get some check from this item, whether it was significantly less than you wanted, whether it's for the exact amount you wanted, or if it's for significantly more. And so I like the fact that it's over and done with after a certain time. Now, having said that, this process with this particular auction house did take a long time. I submitted materials months and months in advance. I'm going to say that I submitted materials in July and the auction is going to be happening, let's say July or August. July, I believe, is when I submitted them. And the auction is going to be happening in December, January, February, and March. They're splitting up into several different auctions. And actually, when I first submitted, they said that the auction was going to be in February. And so I thought it was going to be from July to February. I was going to have to wait. And then they end up moving some of the items earlier to the December auction. But it's quite a long ways to have to wait for things. So you have to plan ahead. I mean, you ship these things out and it takes them a while to get things done. But, you know, for me, I'm like, well, if I could have sold this yesterday, I'd have the money in my pocket. So sometimes with an auction, you also have to plan ahead. You can't necessarily need the money. You can't need the finances from your sale because you have to plan ahead, or you have to continually do these auctions. So, you know, it's something that if I submitted items every 2 months to this auction house, eventually I'd get to the point where every 2 months I would then have a check. It would just be backdated from the previous auctions. And so, you know, eventually you could get to that point if you're going to sell that volume of stuff. But a lot of people don't have the value items or the quantity items to come up with $5,000 minimum for a particular category area in order to sell these items. So my experience so far, if I had to rank them, I would say that this experience has been really great for me with the auction house, knowing that I had to plan ahead, knowing that now, knowing how long it was going to take. Cause I thought, well, I'm going to submit these items and then the next month they're going to have the auction and then I'm going to have a check a couple weeks later. It wasn't that quick. So knowing that now, I would 100% go back to them if I can get that group of items together that are $5,000 or more. With the gallery, I have two pieces there. One is potentially sold, but I haven't heard back from payment because it's on this, maybe on a payment plan, or maybe the person's going to cancel. I don't know. The other item's kind of stuck in this purgatory of artness, this art gallery. So I don't know that I would sell with them again. Not that they weren't great to work with. They were very responsive. They've been nice. They did great photography. They're advertising everything. But I just don't like the fact that I don't know exactly when I'm going to know. At least with the auction, again, I have an idea. Whether I'm going to lose everything, I'm going to sell it for a dollar, I'm going to get 50 cents back, or, well, in that case, 85 cents if you do the appropriate math. But anyway, whether you're going to get nothing for it, or if I'm going to, you know, make bank, or, you know, just break even. With a gallery, I just don't know. I don't know what the date is. It could be 6 months or a year from now, and it could still be sitting there. And then eventually they're like, yeah, we don't want this anymore. Here, pay for shipping to have it back. And so, like, I just don't like that aspect of it. And it might be impatience on my part. I have been selling more things, you know, on some of the casual auction sites, just planning for the appropriate fees. And also, when you put things on those sites, it's different if you're selling one piece. If I'm selling 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 100 pieces of animation art, if you go to a store that has a lot of great feedback and they've got positive responses and they've got a quantity of those types of items, you can put a little bit more faith in the legitimacy of those items, you know, depending on what provenance they offer. But sometimes you're taking a risk with those casual sites anyway. Do you want to purchase an item from a person who has one item for sale, limited feedback, and you don't know anything, or a person that has great feedback and 1,000 or 100 or even 20 different animation cells that look legitimate? It kind of adds a little bit more trust within that particular seller. So I've had good luck with listing multiple items at once and kind of building that trust over time, reselling to people that had purchased from me before, and not having to pay as much in fees or wait. Because when I list those items, they can sit there forever. But I also do it in a way that it's not something that I need that money quickly, or I have enough items where if I post 100 items, let's say, and I only sell 2 a month, it's still going to sell over time. So if those other 80 items sit there all year long, who cares? Because I'm still selling and there's still some profit coming in from those particular pieces. And so I kind of am going with a mixture. So I think what I'm going to be doing is spending more time with those casual auction sites. I've got some people I've worked with in the past that I can work with for private sales. And then as I get some collection together that I think are going to be a little higher value target, then sending it off to that other auction house, I think will be the plan for me. Because honestly, 15%, it's just not bad for me. Now you have to consider that, you know, as a buyer, if I'm going to buy something, I might say my limit is $1,000 on this item, but I'm not going to bid $1,000 because that means I'm going to have to pay $1,200. So the buyers will do the math as well. And they might pay less for an item knowing that they're going to have this buyer's premium. And then you're going to have, you know, your 15% taken off that lower hammer price. And so, you know, it can maybe not work out for your benefit. But as I've seen the prices for the items that I'm listing, I'm hopefully going to sell them for a reasonable price. I'm almost certain I'm going to get more value out of them than I thought I was going to get. And the best thing for me about this auction house experience has been their website. So you can go in and you can check the status of your consignments. You can see how many people are tracking, how many people are bidding on your items, how many views it's received. You can see the exact listing that way it's presented. You can see what date and time it's going to be going on sale. You can follow the item number. You can do all these things so that you feel like you're partially in control of your destiny a little bit. And you can also advertise it yourself. So there's several different social media outlets that I've provided links to the certain cells that I'm selling. I don't know, it's not fun. I know that there's some people in these groups that will like those particular cells from those particular shows or from those particular networks. And I think, well, I might as well advertise to them. So I can do that. I can advertise to them, which I guess I could do that with an art gallery, but the art gallery, it has such a specific clientele, in my opinion. The prices at an art gallery are typically, for me, I don't buy many pieces from art galleries because they tend to feel overpriced for me. But that's because all those different fees that are associated with it and the money that has to be made. And I realize it's a business, but you know, when I see the same piece at an auction house or a casual site and some, and they're not the same, but similar pieces, the prices are just so starkly different. And so if there's not somebody that purchases that piece within the first couple months it's listed, my feel is that it's just going to sit there forever. Because I think that they have lists of people that they've curated that they're going to say, hey, I got a piece in from this particular cartoon series, this particular movie. Are you interested in it? And somebody's either going to snatch it up or not. And I feel like the rest of the time it's just going to sit there. I think that's what happened with the first piece that I sold, is that I actually didn't even see it listed on their website. And I was like, huh. And I contacted them. I said, hey, I didn't list it. And they're like, oh, yep, it's been purchased already. I mean, that was before I even saw it up on the website. I never even actually saw it listed on the website because it sold so quickly. Technically sold. I haven't gotten a check and I don't know if they're on a payment plan or whatever. Anyway, I think that's something to consider as you're looking at your collection and thinking, I want to get rid of some pieces. How should I sell them? Consider the personal aspect, you know, making personal sales, doing local stuff, which is tough because, you know, around my town, people don't see the value. I live in a small town. People don't understand the value of animation art. They don't understand the value of concept art. They don't know that these things are worth money because to them, it's worth nothing. I mean, they might not pay $5 for something where I'd pay $500 for it or $5,000 for it. And so they just don't understand the value. So to sell locally, unless you're living in a particular area that respects or the particular collections that you have, whether it be cells or something completely different, it'd be baseball cards or Ninja Turtles, you know, anything that you have. So the local stuff is tough. Casual auction sites are great, less fees, but not as much trust there. Might have difficulties selling it. Galleries, you know, try it once. That's what I did. And so I'm not trying to discourage you from going with the galleries. I'm giving you what my experience was. If you feel as though you want to try it, go for it, because then you'll know firsthand. I felt like the waiting, unknowing, you know, not knowing was just not for me. And the other auction house, again, make sure you have enough quantity, because, you know, if you don't have that $5,000 minimum, if it's not items that they're really interested in and that they're not hot at the moment, they're looking to make money. All of these places are looking to make money. I mean, that's their business model. So if you have stuff that they're not interested in, they're probably not going to want to sell them. So if you can get something that will make them money, thus it's going to make you money. So the more money they make, the more money you get, which makes me feel that they're working for me. So the more that they made, the more that they sell these things, the higher value, the higher the hammer price, the more money that you're going to get ultimately. So just make sure you plan ahead accordingly, because it does take some time for them to even come up for auction. And then there's a waiting period to receive your check in the mail and all those types of things. So, I mean, I'm looking at this thing I submitted in, I think, July or August, and it's going to be in the new tax year. So I don't have to worry about putting on this year's taxes. I'm going to do it next year because I don't even know what it's going to be worth. So anyway, take some time, but hopefully you enjoyed this video. Hopefully this gives you some idea of what it might be like to consign at a gallery or an auction house. Feel free to comment down below. Let's have a discussion on, you know, if you've consigned something, if you have some recommendations, or if you have questions about my experience, or if you disagree with some of the stuff I said, because this is just my personal experience. I've only ever consigned with a more prestigious gallery and a more prestigious auction house this one time. And I thought, I'm going to just try it, see how it goes. Mainly I've done sales personally or on casual sites, but I kind of wanted to see what it would be like to do it the other way, especially since my collection has grown over the years to have better pieces in it and not, you know, it's different if you're selling a, you know, a $1,500 to $2,000 animation cell versus a $10 to $12 Funko Pop. I mean, those are different collections, and, you know, you're not going to have a Funko Pop auction at one of these big auction houses. So depending on what your collection is, this is, for me, the next stage in that collection. That's another video we're going to be doing soon, is you know, my history of collecting, and also what happens when you want to upgrade your collection. You know, what's the next steps on that, and how do you evolve it over time to kind of increase the value of the collection? So anyway, thanks for watching the Pop Art Hunter channel. Hopefully you enjoyed this video. Check out our other videos, like, comment, subscribe, all those sorts of things. And we will see you next time right here on the Pop Art Hunter channel.